Praise the Lord, everyone. Praise the Lord, everyone. Let's give the Lord a hand praise. We are just thankful to be here on a Sunday morning. Many are doing their own thing, but you all made it important enough in your day to come and to worship. Amen. It means a lot to put Christ in the forefront of your day and to say, I want to take out time to worship our Lord and Savior because He's been good, because He's been faithful, because He made a major sacrifice for us, and that was when He loved us enough to die on the cross. So we're thankful. We want to welcome you to Berea, and we want you to just be at liberty. Let the Lord have His way in your life as we are here to worship and praise and to come for no other reason but to hear the word of God. And we hope in the midst, in the meantime, that we will win souls for Christ. That is our mission, our goal. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So at this time, we're going to open up our service with prayer. And we are going to call on Trisha Casey, if she would come and pray. And then afterwards, we were going to have a scripture. We will ask Diana Lott if she will come with a scripture in that order. Let's receive them by saying amen.
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 Praise the Lord, everyone. Please pray with me this morning. Heavenly Father, God, we thank you this morning, God. You said to enter into your gates with thanksgiving, into your courts with praise. So we just lift you up this morning, Almighty God. It is in you we live, move, and have our being, God. We wouldn't be here without you this morning. Thank you, God, for your faithfulness, the breath of life in our lungs, God. We thank you for bringing us through another week. Yes. Father, I'm looking around this morning, and everyone looks well.
Yes.
Not saying we don't have any problems, God, but we are here. We look well fed. We're clothed and clean, and most of us have a smile on our face, so we thank you, Lord, this morning. We are blessed people, and we just give you the praise this morning, God. Thank you that none of us are in a hospital room this morning, God. Thank you that we're all able to walk in on our own. God, thank you that we have food in the refrigerator and in the pantry. And I just thank you this morning, God. Thank you for your Holy Spirit, God, which fills us and comforts us and guides us. And my heart is just full this morning. Thank you, Lord. So we just bless you today. God, we come for you and you alone. We don't do this out of any form of habit, God. We want to always come, Lord, with the worship in our hearts, to worship you in spirit and in truth, God. And we just ask that you come, Lord. You said we're two or more gathered there. You are in the midst of them. So we are here gathered, Lord, in your name, Jesus. And we are in expectation this morning, God, of what you're going to do, Lord. God, we take you out of the box today. We ask that you have your way, God, in this service. We ask that you bless every part of the service, God, and that you would be well pleased. And we just thank you for Pastor John and Pastor Lynetta, God. I pray that you bless the word today, God. Prepare our hearts. God, let the word fall on good soil, God. Remove any crusty, hard ground, Lord. Give us hearts, Lord, of flesh, Lord, that our lives will be forever changed. And we thank you for what you're doing in our lives, God. We cannot come unless the Father draw us. So thank you for drawing us. And thank you for those that you are drawing, God, because you are always working. You are always moving. We thank you for our family members, God, that have not yet come to the knowledge of Christ yet. But they will, God. We believe you for healings and salvations and deliverance from situations, God, that only you can do and get the glory for. So we just praise you in advance for all the wonderful things that you have in store for us, for this ministry, God. We thank you for our visitors today. We pray that they will be blessed, God. And we just thank you. We love you. We worship you. We honor you because you are worthy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
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 Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. Guys, let's get up on our feet and just begin to worship the Lord. I don't know about you, but I am so excited to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Let's just begin to worship Him. Yes, absolutely. Hallelujah. Lord, we just thank you this morning. I know I'm supposed to just give a word and just read a scripture, but I'm just excited. I don't know about you, but man, He said, enter His courts with praise, right? Man, are you guys not excited? Are we not excited? Think about, let's just reflect for a minute. Let's just think about what He's done, what He's doing, what He's promised us. Man, if that doesn't get you excited, man, I don't know what else will. Man, when I think about His goodness and all He's done, woo, man, something in me just, I'm telling you, I just, I can barely contain myself. Man, God is so good. He is so good. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He sent His Son to die on that old rugged cross. He who knew no sin became sin so that we can now stand confidently and declare that we are the righteousness, the righteousness, the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Do you know that you're in Christ now? You're in Christ now. He calls you the temple beautiful. That's what He calls you, the temple beautiful. That's my scripture. That's what we're going to read. If you would turn with me. Man, that's exciting. I woke up this morning and the Lord gave me, and I was so encouraged this morning. He gave me the scripture, 1 Corinthians 3:16. And I'm going to read the, my Bible is the New International Version. And 1 Corinthians 3:16, the New International Version. Oh boy, Lord, we just thank you this morning.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Jesus. And He says, don't you know that you yourselves are God's temple?
Thank you.
Yeah, I know we shuffled into this building. But you, God's not in this building, He's in you. He's not in this building, He's in you. He says, don't you know that you yourselves are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in your midst? He dwells in you. He dwells in you. That's it. Just want to leave you with that. He dwells in you. So the Spirit of the living God dwells in you. So I want you to think about whatever it is that you have a need for, whatever it is that you are trying, that you're wondering, is it possible? Lord, is, you know, can I accomplish it? Is it possible? Will it come to pass? Is my healing available? If the Spirit of the living God lives in you, then that should be your answer.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Man.
Thank you.
Lord, we thank you.
Lord,
amen.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. We thank God for the prayer and for the scripture. And we are going to have just a few minutes of an encouraging word. We're going to have that by one of our youngest members, Sister Zoe Love. And so she's going to come and give us just a few minutes of encouraging words. And then after that, we're going to have a little bit of meet and greet where we're able to get up and introduce ourselves and tell somebody that you appreciate them being here. And whatever the Lord lays on your heart to speak to that person, maybe they need an encouraging word. Maybe they need a scripture or whatever it is, just a hug, a handshake. Are we able to do that?
Yes.
Amen. We all can encourage somebody along their journey. Amen. So at this time, we're going to have Zoe come and give us some encouraging words.
I am going to be talking about something that I can kind of relate to Miss Diana's word. So a few months ago, I was in Florida, and I had gotten baptized. Mm-hmm. And I remember when I came up from the water, I felt so refreshed. I don't know, I just had a feeling, and it was like, I felt like I could see things new. I felt like I could communicate to God more. So after a few days, we come back to Indiana, Muncie, and we were in church, and the pastor was talking, and I just suddenly got a new understanding. Like, I could understand what the pastor was saying. I could understand what he was talking about. I could relate, you know, because, and then I realized when I came up from that water, God had given me a new vision, a new mind, and he had renewed me. So I really was happy about that. And when I got out of the church, I told Mommy, I was like, Mom, I had new understanding. I could understand what Pastor John was talking about. And she was like, yep, that was because you got baptized and God had given you something new. That's all I wanted to talk about today.
Thank God for those encouraging words. She's so mature. She's only 9 years old, but she's able to convey to you what it is that's in her heart. So at this time, we're going to take a few moments to do some meet and greet. Amen?
Yes.
Amen. So get up, go across the aisle, tell someone something that they need to hear. Amen?
Yes.
Amen.
Thank you.
Which one did you decide on?
What I told you.
Maybe while you're coming down, or not, well, yeah, when you're coming down, I may read that or something.
What is it?
Just do it anyway. I may read that.
What does that mean? What's this?
That's what I read during my Bible study.
Oh, okay, yeah. Just go ahead and share.
Just to give you a few minutes as you're coming down the branch. That's what I'm saying. At this time, we're going to ask the praise team if they would come forward. This is an opportunity for everyone to get involved. So as we worship, we want you to worship with us. If you know the songs, sing them with us. If you don't know the songs, just still worship. Amen? Amen? So come on up, praise team. And our sound guy is not here today, so our pastor is going to be the sound guy, and he's going to help us out from above.
Says, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. When you think about that, all times, that's a word even in itself, because there are so many times we as people can be very conditional. And if I feel like it, I'll do it. But if I don't feel like it today, I'm not going to do it. If I'm sick today, I'm not going to do it. If I'm tired today, I'm not going to do it. But the scripture says, I will bless the Lord at
all times.
At when?
All times.
So we have to remember that he's worthy, because it doesn't matter if you don't feel like it, but do it, because he's an awesome God. He allowed us breath even today. And so we thank God. How many are able to raise your hands? Can you clap your hands? There's so many that can't clap. Some don't have hands. How many can stump their feet? That's a blessing. Amen?
Yes.
So we want you to do that. And if you feel like running, we want you to run.
Yes.
Amen?
Hallelujah.
Amen. There's a blessing even in that.
To be able to run,
to stomp, to clap. And so we bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in our mouths. Amen?
Amen.
Yes.
There's nothing worthwhile that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You are living home. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves. where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord.
Hallelujah. Light in the
Let's give the Lord another hand praise. We We thank God that He is a wonderful Savior. Amen. He's the head of our life. He's a master. And He will solve problems for you. Amen. He's a problem solver. He's a heart fixer. He's a chain breaker. Amen. Can anybody testify to that? How He'll just answer your prayers. On Wednesday, we have Bible study here. And this past Wednesday, I was able to teach on freedom. And for those that were here, we talked a lot about freedom and what that means, and how when the Lord comes into your heart, He'll free you of so many things. Amen. And one of the things that I read, and I'm going to read it as the pastor is getting ready to prepare to speak. It was a document that Mother Teresa wrote, and it was called Do It Anyway. So those that were here on Wednesday, I want you to help me a little bit with the end of that sentence when I get to Do It Anyway. And what I was encouraging the people on Wednesday is that there are many things that we suffer or that we go through in life. And sometimes we don't always want to have the right spirit or the right attitude, because let's just admit it, we are who we are. We're people, and we do have flaws and character deficits and that kind of thing. But in the midst of it all, we have a God that lives inside us. And that if people need to see the God in you, you need to make the right choices. And sometimes we have a tendency to go left instead of doing the right thing. Amen? So it's called Do It Anyway. People are often unreasonable, irrational, and self-centered. Forgive them anyway. If you are kind, people may accuse you of selfish, ulterior motives. Be kind anyway. If you are successful, you will win some unfaithful friends and some genuine enemies. Succeed anyway. If you are honest and sincere, people may deceive you. Be honest and sincere anyway. What you spend years creating, others could destroy overnight. Create anyway. Some of you are a little slow on the anyway. Do it anyway. If you can find serenity and happiness, some people may be jealous. Be happy
anyway.
All right, that sounds better. You're getting it, as we're almost done. Amen. The good you do today will often be forgotten. Be good
anyway.
Thank you. All right. Give the best you have, and it will never be enough. Give your best
anyway.
In the final analysis, it is between you and God. It was never between you and them
anyway.
So Mother Teresa wrote that, but I felt like it was so appropriate for what we were talking about, right? Because in life, there are sometimes we want to be unlovable, but love. There are some times when we are angry and frustrated, but be happy
anyway.
There are some times our job and our coworkers can get on our nerves, but love them
anyway.
And so that was the whole purpose of what we sometimes go through, because we can have a tendency to do things in the wrong motives, the wrong spirit, and not allow us to be freed from the love that God has given us, or freed from things that we should let go, should I say. And we can do that in a way of just giving it back to the Lord and doing the right thing anyway. Even when no one is looking, do the right thing anyway. And I praise God, because there are times, sometimes you just want to do something and no one's around, right? Take that paperclip from work, or steal that pen that no one's looking. Those are things. But no matter what it is, you have an opportunity to do the right thing anyway. And the scripture that I shared with them following that was over in Colossians 3, 23 and 24. And it says, "And whatsoever you do, do it heartily as unto the Lord and not unto men, knowing that our Lord ye shall receive the reward of the inheritance, for ye serve Lord Christ, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
So we must do it anyway, and we thank God for that freedom that he has given us in Christ, because we have a friend in Jesus. Amen. We can take things to the Lord in prayer. We can do away with a lot of unnecessary things if we just ask him to be head of our life, to lead us, to guide us into all truth. Amen. Because that's what the Holy Spirit does for us. Give the Lord a hand praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We thank God. And so at this time, we're going to call on our pastor, Pastor John Lee. He is going to come and give us what the Lord has given him. So let's receive him at this time by saying amen.
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 Praise the Lord. Good morning. Good morning. Hope everyone is doing well. God bless you. We got a little rain today to cool us off, I guess, Sister Nisa. We thank God for another day in his house. Thank him for his goodness and his mercy, his kindness. Amen. We're going to be in the book of Luke this morning. So if you have your Bibles or your devices, go over there. Try not to be too long. But we don't want to hinder what God is doing. Amen. Thank God for a place to come and worship. We got some good air, so hopefully it's not too cold for you. I always bring something extra to put on, because I'm typically cold. So if it's too cold, just mention something. The book of Luke was something that we hope that God might, through the Spirit, help to impress upon our minds this morning. As believers, we always encourage you to not leave your mind at the door, but go ahead and bring it in here with you. So God might get some glory out of our lives. The Bible says that it is with the mind that we serve the Lord. Yes. With our mind, that is where everything gets going. So if I don't go to work on Monday, it started right up here. Thought all day Sunday about sleeping in. So a lot of times we are focusing on the external things that need attention, and we have disconnected it from the root of the problem. Amen. That's a good teaching this morning. So we always want to remember that faith is how we stay connected to God. So when we're not bearing good fruit in our lives, it is a product of not being connected to him through faith. Jesus said, I am the vine, ye are the branches. And if you stay connected to me, somebody say, stay connected.
Amen.
We stay connected through, of course, prayer and faith. And I like to not throw out obedience. I think obedience is important too. Glad obedience, of course, glad obedience. And we thank God for when we do go astray, he has made the pathway for our righteousness and a way back to him. Amen.
Amen.
Thank God for a way back today. Luke 15, if you have your Bibles, Luke 15. Let's stand if this morning we'd like to stand in honor of God's word. The Bible says all scripture is given by inspiration of God. It's good for doctrine, for reproof, for instruction in righteousness, that the man and the woman might be thoroughly furnished, ready for every good work. Are you ready this morning?
Yes.
Amen. We got some ready folk this morning. I like it. We need the word of God. It is through the word of God that brings interest, light into our heart. Luke 15, 1 through 7 reads thusly, then drew near unto him all the publicans and sinners to hear him, everybody. And the Pharisees and scribes murmured, saying, this man receives sinners and eats with them. And he spake this parable unto them, saying this, what man of you, having 100 sheep, if you lose one of them, doth not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after that which is lost until he find it? And when he hath found it, he layeth it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he cometh home, he calleth together his friends and neighbors, saying unto them, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep, which was lost. Verse 7, I say unto you that likewise joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that repenteth, more than over 99 just persons, which think they need no repentance. And may God add a blessing to the reading, hearing, preaching, teaching, and understanding of the word. You may be seated in Jesus' name. I would like to take a topic just for a few minutes this morning. This man received sinners. This man received sinners. This man received sinners. We enjoy the Gospels. All of them have something particularly to bring forth in your study that are particularly interesting. Luke, the Gospel that we are in, sets forth to show us the humanity of Christ, that he was all man. And if he smashed his finger in the door, it hurt. Amen. He had days when his physically, he was tired. Jesus, God in the flesh, grew up from a child into a man, just like we do. The Bible says in Hebrews, we do not have a high priest that cannot be touched with every feeling of our infirmity. Every sad day we've had, God knows all about it. If you've had times of fear and doubt, God knows all about it. If you struggle with depression, Jesus knew all about it. If you struggle with the will of God at times, Jesus knew all about it. He said, Father, if it be thy will, let thy cup pass from me. But it is important to understand that God knows all about our trouble. And in our Christian pilgrimage, I guess, there are times when we question whether or not he knows. But I'm here to encourage you and try to convince you this morning that Jesus knows all about your trouble. He is in touch with all of our afflictions, is what Isaiah said. That in all our afflictions, he was afflicted. If you're like me, sometimes I wonder what in the world is going on. Am I the only one this morning? What in the world is going on in my life? At 47 years old, Sister Lot, still have days when I ask God, what in the world is going on? But I thank God for his word, because it brings us joy and faith, and it is the substratum of faith. We cannot get faith anywhere else. It is from the word of God that faith emerges. So I encourage you to read your word. Amen. Love your word. Proclaim your word. Put confidence in that word. The Bible says we ought to hold it deep in our heart that we might not sin against him. Hallelujah. When we look into the text today, we find that God is at work again in Jesus. He's always ministering, and the Bible says he's ministering even right now in the church. That even though our physical bodies come here, we have a high priest ministering spiritually in the church. No man can do it. God had to do it. We are still conduits of his word, and we believe that the preaching and teaching of God's word is absolutely necessary. It's one of the word gifts, apostles and prophets and pastors and teachers and those things. But we thank God for his ministry right here in the church in Jesus. Can I get amen this morning? Let's give God a hand praise. For Jesus. But when we look into the text this morning, the Bible lets us know that there are a group of people who are not happy with what God is doing. Today there's groups of people that are not happy with what God is doing. Much of the trouble we see in the world has to do with the fact that people have opposed God's word. Amen. But even in a quest to do the right thing, we can mess it up. We find that people and groups fight each other trying to determine which one is doing the right thing, what we call righteousness in the church. We have acquiesced to the fact that the only true righteousness is not in a nation or a group or a creed or a political party, but the only true righteousness comes by faith in Jesus Christ. Anybody got that righteousness this morning? Give God another hand, please. For the righteousness that comes through faith. There were a group of men we call the Pharisees and the Sadducees in the days of Jesus, about 6,000, 10,000, a group of men, priests, Jewish, had to be Jewish to be a priest in the day of Christ. And not only that, but you couldn't have any physical defects. If you had so much as a drawn up hand or any issues physically, you couldn't be a priest. But all those were a type, and the requirements were the type of him who would come one day who would be without spot and without blemish. And of course, that was Jesus Christ, our great high priest. But unfortunately, the people who God gave to be the conduit of the word and to bring the gospel message got caught in sort of in a tunnel, as it were. You know, you can get in a tight crawl space and get stuck and can't get out. And the Bible lets us know that the ones who God originally delivered the word to and the law to stumbled at Jesus, didn't like what they saw in his coming. And the Apostle Paul touches on it in Romans 9, of course, when he says, I wish myself could be cursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my people, the Jews. Today, the Jewish nation and the nation of Israel is in a large part not only defectors of Jesus Christ and have denied him as his sonship, but have made a wholesale defection of faith. A lot of people want to rush to Israel and see this glorious thing, but what you'll find in large part is people who don't believe in God at all. Now, you didn't know that maybe this morning, but you can do your homework later. But he says, I wish I was accursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my people Israel. He says theirs is the adoption to sonship. They received these things from God. He brought them out with a mighty hand. They had the divine glory. Pillar of fire by night and cloud by day. They had the covenants. They received the law there at Sinai, which was a good law. They were given all the instructions to temple worship and the promises. They are the patriarchs, Paul says, from whom is traced the human ancestry of the Messiah, who is God over all and forever praised. Amen. They had everything they needed from God. They had his word. They had the providence. God had given them the land. But they got stuck on stupid religiously. They had a problem, what we call in the church, self-righteousness. In their minds, the law, which we understand later, which could not bring about the righteousness that God brought about in Jesus, they thought the law could do it for them. And not only that, did they have the law of God, they had the moral law, they had the ceremonial law, and they're different. They had those things in their hand. They had the Ten Commandments, and you'd think if they had them in their hand, they could look down on a daily basis and say, I haven't kept these things today, let alone this year or in my life. But they were struggling what we call self-righteousness, and there are some characteristics of self-righteousness, and I'd like to just touch on a few. We don't want to be this thing. We don't want to be this pharisaical type of person. We don't want to have a self-righteousness attitude. But in the church, it's easy because we've been blessed. We've been given something that we didn't deserve. We have been given salvation. God has put his spirit inside of us because we had faith in him. And we have to make sure that we always examine ourselves to make sure we know where the power rests. First Corinthians says that we have this power in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power, the glory of it, might not come from us, but from God. Amen. Thank God for his anointing. I thank God for the power of prayer. I thank God for victory. Yes, somebody ought to clap this morning. These are wonderful things. I thank God for the power of intercession. I thank God for the evidence that I have of sanctification and holiness in my life. But when I'm done talking about those things, I have to declare that it was God that did it and not myself. As the psalmist said, he brought me out of the pit, out of the mire clay. God did these things. When he worked in Israel, he did the same thing. He brought them out with an outstretched hand. They didn't have any help. They were slaves. They couldn't help themselves. But God did it. That's what he does. He delivers. Then he commands. So we find out that after he has delivered, he has commanded, he has given the adoption, the glory, the covenant, the giving of the law, the temple worship, and these wonderful things, that these people became puffed up in pride. The same people who were supposed to be mentoring and bringing people to faith were self-righteous. And they struggled with self-righteousness. And I want to give you just a few characteristics. One of them is they did not see their walk with God as a community project. Amen. They didn't see their walk with God as a community project. And you can write them down or you can watch it later or whatever. But the work of God and our walk with God is supposed to be connected to other people. People who need the Lord. You say, how are we going to grow as a church? Here it is. We're going to have to connect with sinners. We're going to have to connect with people who don't have the law of God, not in their hand, but written in their heart. The Lord said, I will come one day and I will remove away that commandment, but I'm going to write something else in your heart, the Spirit of the Lord that's going to guide you. You won't need a piece of paper anymore. You won't need physical instruction when God is moving in your life. You don't need no instruction. The Spirit lets you know what you ought to do. The Bible says we no longer need teachers. Amen. That's a good statement there. But they didn't see the law, the walk with God, their own walk with God, as a community project. As a church, we have to reach out and we have to try to create avenues and ways to reach people. The lost must be reached. Yes. The sheep must be touched. Yes. The sheep must be found. Amen. And when they're found, we're going to rejoice. Somebody say amen to that. Amen. We're going to rejoice. So number two is this. They did not work well with others. They did not work well with others. One of the outworks of self-righteousness is not working well with others. I don't want you to think that your lack of working with people and being a part of a community is some high doctrine that you've ascended upon. No, no, no. It's actually you have descended. The Bible says, I believe in Proverbs, that those that exclude themselves, one, are selfish, and they throw out sound reasoning. I had five sons, and they get mad. They go off on their own. I said, well, you're just hurting yourself. We're having a good time in the other room. We're having a great time. And your mouth is all turned up, and you're upset, and you're mad, and you're breathing out stuff, and ain't nobody there. Soliloquy to himself. One of the outworks of self-righteousness is they did not work well with others. And in God's providence and his kingdom, if you're going to be a great kingdom worker, you have to work well with others. Yeah. And you'll have to figure out what that looks like. Because that's going to mean you decreasing and God increasing. Some of your ways and the things you brought to your faith have to go out the window. There is nothing that we bring to faith that God can use. The way you spent your money, how you give, how you love, how did you treat your wife, none of that stuff works. Until God writes his law in your heart, you've got the wrong thing in there. And we come along slowly, don't we? So it takes a little while to realize that, okay, maybe God was right and I was wrong. One, they didn't see their walk with God as a community project. No person is saved to live in isolation. God has brought us all into community, into a family of believers somewhere. I tell people, you ain't got to come to this church, but find a church to come to. You're missing out on the very thing that Jesus died on the cross for. And you don't come to church and you want fellowship with folks? What a shame. that he died to break down the middle wall of partition between those two great social, economical, and religious status, and then we find ourselves in 2022 and won't fellowship. What a shame. Don't be that person. The Bible says in Hebrews 10:25, maybe Bishop 28 on the other, help me. But he says, forsake not the assembly of yourselves, what?
Together.
As such as some is. Don't be some. Don't let the devil work on your mind to make you think that you've blessed somebody or yourself by not fellowshipping. But that's what the Pharisees did. They were self-righteous. They said, we don't need these people. They are barbarians, and they're doing these things, and they smoke, and they do these things. I wish I could go in on this. But they didn't see themselves in their own issues. Now, they themselves had issues. They themselves had sin that needed the blood of Jesus to cover. But they didn't see anybody's. So Jesus had to go on and on and on and tell them and give them little shivlets of grace, is what I call it. Little small things like behold the speck in your brother's eye when you got a 2x4 in your own head. I said, my God, I got an eye beam in my head? Yes. If you're self-righteous and you have a large beam in your head, you can't see anything, how could you possibly see something small wrong in your brother's life?
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
They consistently believe they are right and know best. This is a scary thing. As pastors and bishops, we understand that we have to always guard against thinking we're always right. We've got to open up the aisles to hear people talk, and because we don't have it all. Apostle Paul said, I have not attained yet in Philippians. He said, I have not got there yet. So ain't no need for us to sit up here and like we got it all buttoned up. If he was the apostle of grace, the giver of the gospel to us, and he hadn't attained yet, then I feel okay. I'm all right. Okay? I'm just going to be where I am. But they consistently believe were right. You very rarely will you see, and I'm going to have to do my homework, a Pharisee say that somebody else was, that he was wrong and someone else was right. How many times this? I had a man apologize to me this week. That was part of the union there at General Motors. I said, that's the first time I've ever had somebody on your side say sorry in a year and a half and hundreds of disputes. But it's always a blessing when we acknowledge the fact that we can be wrong. Yeah, we can be wrong. I don't care how long you've lived or how long you've been studying for something. I took a calculus class at Ball State to finish my bachelor's degree, and the lady often would say, oh, yeah, I forgot that. I said, what a blessing, because I don't know what's going on in this class. They are resistant to change. Number four, church is one of the hardest places to change somebody's mind. One of the hardest places. We get an old program and say, we're going to go with this program, and we're going to go this, this, and that. And if one little thing goes different, we go crazy. Don't they? I was upstairs, but Sister Zoe, did you share some encouraging words today?
Yes.
That may get underneath some self-righteous people's skin. I said, that ain't what was on the program. I need to go to a church where the pastor got some order and knows what he's doing. But the Lord wanted me to have a word of encouragement. So that's what we did. Self-righteous people don't like change. My father used to watch Archie Bunker. He loved it. He'd be watching crazy old Archie Bunker. But Archie Bunker didn't want no change. And we got some Archie Bunkers here. I'm one of them. I tell my wife, I don't want no change at the house. It's hard. I got to pray. I said, Lord, help me. I'm just used to stuff the way it is. We like to keep things the same. But the Bible says this in Isaiah, behold, I do a new thing, and you do not perceive. So we find out that the very gospel that God tries to bring, we have this self-righteous attitude and mindset more than anything that says certain people can't come to God. Certain people can't be ministered to. All we look at is how they're dressed. Has he got a tie on? Is he wearing a cross? Does he look like this? Is his piercings right? What kind of makeup does they have on? Does he have tattoos? Enough! Behold, he's done a new thing.
Yes.
We don't perceive it. Having eyes, we can't see it. And ears, we can't hear it. But the heaven rejoices when someone comes to God. Behold!
Yes. this man received sentence. Glory to God. Number five is they didn't respond well when reminded that they needed to change. Not only did they not want the external things around them to change, we need this to be 5 feet from here all the time. Let me count this out. And if it's less than 5 feet, that wasn't just their problem. They didn't like it when other people reminded them that they needed to change. This is one of the great challenges of gospel ministry, whether you be just a minister or a pastor or whatever you do. This is one of the great challenges, is actually convincing people that they need to change. If you go on Facebook, you'll see every single post is telling somebody else what they need to do. Isn't it easy to tell everybody else what they need to do? But the Bible says examine yourself to see if you be in the faith. And that's when you find a strong Christian. If you want to see an elevation in your life, if you want to see God promote you, learn to examine yourself, because you can't do two things at once. Johnny's walk is a full-time job. And the moment I try to, I'm not talking about closing your eyes. The Bible says watch and pray. We do not remove the ability to use your eyes to perceive. God has given your eyes as a blessed gift. And he talks a lot about spiritual blindness and physical blindness. But nevertheless, we thank God. We thank God. Number six, they did not desire others' exhortation or admonishing, and they even got angry at times. These are all really just characteristics of self-righteousness. See, the most self-righteous person isn't actually in church. You didn't know that? The most self-righteous person is the person who don't think they need God at all. I ain't coming to God's house. I'm good. I know I'm better than that brother that sits in that seat because I knew him 86. Matter of fact, I knew him last year, and I know what she does today. They think that God is measuring people on some sort of grading scale and some sort of curve, you see. I went to school, and I got an F on a test, and it was not a normal F. It was like a 40% F. But that man put that thing on the curve and it lifted me up higher. I said, hey! And I looked up and I had a C before you knew it. And I emailed that professor. I said, you're one of the best professors here at this fine institution. And you have all my support. Doctor. But God is not graving on no curve. God has declared that everybody has fallen short of his glory. And I don't care if you almost dunked the basket or you couldn't touch the net. We all fail when it comes to God. All have sinned, fallen short of the glory of God. The Bible says that Christ died for us. He laid on him the iniquities of us all, that all of our sins he carried away. Just as this text said that the lamb was carried away, God put us on his shoulder. We couldn't walk anymore. We couldn't advance anywhere spiritually. We were spiritually dead. We weren't just lost. We were dead. That's Ephesians 2. But God, who was rich in mercy, whereby he loved us, by grace you are saved through faith, not of yourselves. It's the gift of God. Somebody say grace. The grace of God. They did not desire exhortation or admonition, and they got angry when someone tried to correct them. People don't get angry when the pastor tries to give you something that you need. I say the pastor because sometimes people get outside of church and then they play pastor. Don't do that. We only got one pastor here. It's me. The Bible said, no man takes his title upon themselves, and if you knew the struggles you did with, you wouldn't want to do it anyway. Amen. Yeah, you don't have to. You got to have the grace to do it. Amen. I mean, some days you can't get up. Some days, ain't that right, Bishop? Some days you can't get up and God lifts you up. You know what I'm talking about. Whatever God calls you to do, he'll give you the grace to do it. So much that you understand that it's not us, but it's God. Don't deny both encouragement and admonition. Don't be angry about it. Number seven, they are not patient with those who mess up or struggle with sin or who have lost. Oh, this is a big one. Write this down. They are not patient with people who mess up and struggle with sin. These self-righteous people are not patient with people who mess up or struggle with sin. But yet they themselves mess up and struggle with sin. Carrying around that law with no sort of shame or guilt at all, because we all need shame and is a beautiful gift from God and repentance. But not coming as if I've actually achieved this day. You've never dunked a basketball in God's eyes. You never reached the net. We've all sinned, fallen short of the glory of God. Another version says we're all sinning and have still fallen short of the glory. We need his blood. That's why the Bible says we need his blood, because the blood runs constantly through your body. It never stops. It don't need prompting. You don't know how it runs. It ain't hooked up to no plug. It constantly works. It's bringing everything the body needs. It's bringing in good stuff. It's taking out bad stuff. Somebody say, thank God for the blood. It's the blood that gives me strength from day to day. It's the blood of Jesus. That's what God's trying to say. When the blood stopped flowing, life is done. That's why the coroner checks his wrist to see if the blood is flowing. We only have salvation through the blood of Jesus. That should be pretty simple to understand, can't you? There ain't no pulse.
Yes, my God.
The blood of Jesus is why we're here. They were not patient with people doing the same thing they did 8 months ago, 4 years ago. Mad at the 18-year-old girl for how she dresses. You get out the old pictures, look just like her. Mad at him because he got two babies by two different people and did the exact same thing. It's a problem. It's a problem.
Yeah. Thank you.
But if you don't work it out in your mind, you'll be doing the same thing that they did. Yes. We say hurt people, hurt people. Yes. Don't let that be you. Yes. Solomon told his son in the Bible, he said, let not mercy and truth forsake thee. Bind them about thy neck. Write it on the tables of your heart. So shalt thou find favor in the sight of God and man. Trust in the Lord with all thy heart. Lean not into thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he will direct thy path. They weren't patient with people who were messing up. Because in this walk, you're going to mess up. In this walk, you're going to struggle. And the Bible has made some great promises for those people who struggle. He said, behold, I'll go with you always, when? Even until the end of the world. He said, a bruised reed I shall not break, and a smoking flax he will not quench. God doesn't crush you and kick you when you're down, but he gives power to the faint, strength to the weak. He gives knowledge to the dumb. He gives salvation to the humble. He glorifies the meek with salvation. My God and your God, that's the God I'm talking about. This man received sinners, and we ought to be happy about it, because we are sinners. That's really where I'm at. We're sinners in need of God's grace. Yes, yes. If we ain't sinners, then what do I need a Savior for? And if I'm self-righteous, what do I need God for? If I got it all buttoned up, what do I need God for? Oh, no, no. I got issues. I got problems. And I got the blood of Jesus Christ. I got the testimony of the gospel. I got a preparation to give an answer for the hope that is within me. They weren't patient people who messed up, or who had lost their way. So Jesus goes into a very simple parable. Which one of you, if you had a sheep? You know there are people that like animals more than people. It's not right. You mess with them Peter folks, you're going to get in trouble. They'll be at your door. Don't mess with Peter. People for the ethical treatment of animals. And I got a dog, and sometimes I get after that dog, but that dog is a dog. Jesus didn't die for that dog. He died for people. He died for us. It took a human to save a human. Somebody who was in touch with every problem. I don't know what that dog's thinking. Woo! I said, what? And my wife, she'd get down there trying to be the dog whisperer. I said, that dog, we don't know what that dog wants. She said, what, does he want to go outside, honey? I don't know. He asked me things I can't give an answer to. I don't know what he wants. She's crazy. The dog. It's a sheep. You won't, I ain't get no trouble out of me. You're no trouble out of me. Okay. They do not deal well with opposition and accusations. As a Christian, you're going to have to learn to confront trouble.
Yeah.
Very simple. I don't like it. That's not my style. But I learned that I've got to learn at times. Look, to everything there is a season. There's a time to love and a time to hate, a time to cast away and time to bring together, a time for war and a time for peace. And whatever you want to bring, you just bring it on. Just bring it on. If you want to come to my house start trouble, well, we got some trouble for you. If you want to come into the church trying to change the pews and change, well, we got something for you. If you got some here crazy doctrine that you want to bring here, we got something for you, the Word of God. We don't start no trouble. That's why we got these peace lilies up here. You see the dove. Why we put the peace lilies up here. Y'all don't take that peace lily off of there. We wanted peace to be up here. The Bible says that he came and preached peace. If you as a minister are not preaching peace to your family, then what are you doing? Because your ministry is first to your family. And don't nobody in your family like you. Why? Because you're supposed to be a people of peace. James says the servant of the Lord must not strive. Some people hang their hat on the fact that, well, I sure can kick up a dust. Just let me get in there. Just let me get in there. I can really get it going. Well, that shouldn't be the child of God. He was the Prince of Peace. The Bible has some great promises about the peace that God brings. The peace that passes all understanding. Peace is one of the fruits of the Spirit. Okay? But there's a time for opposition. They didn't deal well with opposition or accusation. As a pastor, a leader, and some of us are managers at work, and we got some sisters, she works in HR. It's not easy to come out and tell this person, look, I hate to tell you, but we got to take some steps. Yeah. And in your Christian walk, if you don't ever, can't nobody approach you about steps that we got to take, you'll never grow. Yes. You'll be 50, 60, 70, 80, and be 12 spiritually.
That's right.
Because the only way you can grow is through instruction. Yeah. The word gifts given in Ephesians are strictly word gifts. There are people who can to interpret the word and deliver it to you for your edification. Just as you eat physical bread, that word that you receive now, but if you got your hand out and don't feed me, how are you going to grow? You can't grow without food, can you? You're going to die without food. Spiritually, we'll find ourselves cut off from God without receiving his word. And the Bible says the rulers are not there for your terror. They're there to help you, not just rulers in pastors in church, but even on your job.
Yes.
That person is not there. They're for your good.
Yes.
That's what the Bible says.
Amen.
And some people go every day and say, I'm going to tell this manager off today. Well, don't do that. And then be on social media quoting scriptures. I don't get it. Inconsistent life. We don't want that. They will consistently wonder why God has singled them out for difficulty. Nobody knows the trouble I've seen. Child of God, everybody knows the trouble because you told everybody. They don't see, they see their struggle as something particularly difficult, and God has singled them out. We're not singling people out. It just is what it is. If I'm struggling, someone needs to say something to me. I purposely make myself accountable to three people, not the whole city, but three people. I've got my father-in-law who's a bishop, my former bishop, and then I've got a friend that I also purposely make myself accountable to. Because if you are not accountable to anybody, that's going to be like leaving the fox in charge of the hen house. You're going to be making your own rules.
Right.
Oh, maybe I'll get up, maybe I won't. Maybe I'll do it, maybe I won't. I'm not accountable to you, I'll do what I want. This freedom sure is wonderful. The Bible says don't use your freedom as a cloak of maliciousness. If you've really been set free in Christ, it's not a reason for you to just string that thing around. Yeehaw! No, that is not how God works. He delivers. He delivers, and then he commands. He brought them out of Egypt, and as soon as they got out of Egypt, whoa, there's Sinai. What you doing here, God? Yeah, I brought you out so you serve me. I didn't cut you loose so you could go run around Sinai and go into all these strange lands. No! No. The Bible says that for the very purpose of holiness, he has called us to a holy calling. Yes. Holiness is a beautiful thing in the life of a Christian. Everybody wants a husband that don't cheat. Everybody wants a wife that's submissive. Everybody wants children that are obedient. Nobody wants to be lied to, do you? There's nothing greater than holiness. They're still trying to figure out downtown how to do it. We got the word. We can tell you how to do it. You making laws and policies and you trying to do all these different things and none of it's going to work until God comes into a person's life. They did not see a need to confess or admit their sins. That was the problem. Okay? That was the problem. And they consistently pointed out the sins of others with an air of superiority. In your own life, you have to have sort of a governor. You know, on the fast cars, they'll put a governor that keeps it from going too fast. One, because you don't need to go that fast. You need to get in an airplane if you need to go 160. It's safer there. That's where we want people that wants to go super fast. Okay? But in our own lives, we need to slow down and can see why am I constantly pointing out sins of other people. If we slow down, if we meditate in our Christian walk, God will bless you. Being a Christian, a strong Christian, requires meditation. It requires a slowness that we need to evaluate stuff. Because you get mad, and if you make a decision, all your decisions in anger, you'll never get the right decision. Because your emotions are not a good compass for what you need to do. I get mad, and then every day we have at work what we call a cool-off period. It's a time when the worker does something wrong and the time that I have to discipline him. Do not make a decision for 24 hours. They've said you need a cool-off period, and they're right, because I'd be ready to get rid of folks in anger. But that's not what God wants. He has desired mercy. That's what God wants. He wants patience. If General Motors figured it out, yeah. I'm sure we could figure it out in God's house. Self-righteous people consistently point out the sins of other people. We have to slow down. That's the instruction. Slow down, examine our own self, pray, ask God what he wants to do. Okay? When we look at the text today, just quickly, these tax collectors and sinners that drew near to Jesus, large number of people, we need to remember that the life and the ministry of Jesus was unmatched. Because of the power of the words that he spoke. But he spoke a parable to let them know sometimes God has to use word images and pictures. And I'll tell you what, God can deliver any way he wants. He can give you a vision. He's God. He's not limited. But he chose to use parables to sort of bring it down to the simple understanding. If you can't understand how to treat your brother or your sister right, let's talk about the animal that you have, that you bought that super soft Serta bed for. Got hard beds in the back for the guests and got a Serta for the pup. Soft food for the dog, hard food for the guest. Jesus knows how to deliver a message. He said, what man of you having 100 sheep, if he loses one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after that one, an animal that you need to get the work done clearly? Now, he already knew the answer. The answer was yes. Every one of them was going, this thing is profitable to me. And if you're like, if he was like most of us, he probably named it. Don't we name every animal we got? Bessie, George, Paul, something. We're gonna get, so this was valuable to him. Jesus knew it. He knows right where to reach us in our understanding, don't he? Yeah, let's talk about the animal. If you had one, he was lost, would you go after it? Yes, you would. He said, and when you find it, you would throw it on your shoulders. You would carry that sheep all the way home. And when you got back, you would rejoice and give God praise, and your friends would rejoice just as well. He said, yes, you would do this. You would leave 99 good ones and go after the one. And this morning, I just want to encourage you, Church of God. Each one of us got a ministry. Each one of us got a gospel message to carry. Each one of us got a story to tell. And God wants you to go after somebody this week and bring them back into fellowship. And maybe that lost one is you, and God wants me to let you know that he's going after you today. He's going to bring you back into fellowship by the power of his Spirit. He is more concerned about you than he's worried about anybody else. He knows when we mess up. He knows we got a propensity to go wrong. And he is constantly seeking to bring us back into fellowship with us. Yes. And with him.
Thank you, Lord.
This man receives sinners. Give God a hand praise. Hallelujah. You come, dear. We thank the Lord. This week we are going to park cars for the fair, and we need much help as we can get. Sometimes at church, I think we just assume stuff is going to get done. If we don't give weekly, the lights won't be on. The mortgage won't be paid. Very simple. God is not raining. We don't have a money tree here. If we don't tend to the yard and we don't see about these things, the grass won't get cut. Okay? It's very simple. If someone doesn't come in and clean the carpets and vacuum and take care of those things, it's not going to happen. So when we talk about service to God, here's a great place. We can start here with the people of God and then work our way out. Remember, Jesus sent people out in twos. Yoke up with somebody that you enjoy working with. It's fun to work with people in the church. Now, you don't have to worry about all that other stuff you got going on. Just two believers, just love the Lord, bearing one another's burdens. So we don't want to throw those things aside. I encourage you to continue to give. You remember our place on Willard. We still own that place. We still owe things to them. So continue to give week after week. Some of us, if we don't go to church that week, we don't give that week. But God wants, it's a biblical principle to give God first. Some of us wait till Friday. That's too late. You done ate 8-9 pizzas. You bought 3 pairs of Converse, 2 pairs of Nikes. You gave your drunk uncle some money. You ain't got nothing left for God. Use your brain. Take some right off the top. Don't question it. You prosper. Haven't we prospered in our lives? Physically? How? Because we never, and I'm not trying to brag. We know how to get back. It's a divine principle. It's a nature of law. Everything gives. The Bible says, believing in Ezekiel, he said, all the rivers run into it, but the sea is not full. You know, God is a generous giver. And just freely has he given, and freely have we all received. And how does the sea not get full if every river runs into it? Because it's constantly giving up. It's always giving up. And when it don't give out, it gives up. Oh, that's a revelation right there. And then we come ourselves as child of God and say, I ain't giving nothing. You know, I'm not giving nothing. God forbid the pastor takes $20 and goes on vacation. But we ain't went on vacation, have we? We're not with somebody else's money. We go with our own money, don't we? Yeah, we made good money, don't we? Yeah, we made a whole bunch of money. But we made a whole bunch of money because God blesses. And this is what I want to ask you today. Can God trust you with kingdom things? If he can't trust you with kingdom things, then he can't trust you. He won't give you anything he can't trust you with. There's a reason why we're here. God can trust us. We have proven that we're trustworthy. Not perfect. Not by a long shot. But trustworthy. So as we continue to come, give, you know. And I remember in the scripture, there was a lady who just gave a mite, a small portion, but that's all she had. And she got a memorial from God. I'm not sure even what that all entails. But we're still talking about her today. Because she just gave what she had from the abundance of her heart. You know, I remember years ago, sorry, honey, you can come back here and sit down. I've got you on the clock. Ronald Reagan had what he called an initiative called trickle-down theory. And I said, I just was sitting back watching. I said, no, this ought to be interesting. Do you think them people are going to let it trickle down to somebody else? People are not giving. People are stingy. You're trusting people to give? Oh, man, good luck with that. And I'm not talking about Republicans. I'm talking about Democrats, independents, all of them. The Bible says it's hard for a rich man to enter into the kingdom. And it gives a parable about a man who his whole salvation was hinged on the fact that he couldn't give nothing up. But if you can't give nothing up, then you can't receive nothing either. Freely has he given. Freely have we all received. Paul said, if we've given you spiritual things, shouldn't we ought to be able to receive something physical? There's nothing like getting a spiritual blessing. No, man. I'm telling you what, a job can pay you. And I'll go from job to job. It wouldn't matter to me because there's more important things to getting physical payment. And that's to get a spiritual blessing. It was the spiritual anguish that really had Jesus undone at the cross. That we talk about the physical pain, but we never tapped into the spiritual trouble we have. Aren't most of your struggles really spiritual? I mean, when you battle internally, isn't that the real trouble? Money's really not it, is it? I mean, money comes and goes. Just look at it. You can crush it up. It folds. It doesn't last very long. It tears easy. It's constantly losing value. But there is something that has always been the standard, and that is gold. And Jesus said, purchase of me gold. Try it in the fire. He's talking about faith. There is something that doesn't perish away. You know, not no dead presidents. But at the same time, God has the principle of first fruits, that the first of all we give. The first to trust him. I tell people, there's nothing wrong with reading other books, but the Bible has to always be the principle of your faith, the foundation of your faith. There ain't nothing wrong with these help books. Read all you want, but they have to be secondary to the Bible. The fear of the Lord is what? The beginning of wisdom, not as a point of departure. We say beginning, oh, that's the start line. No, as a point of reference for everything I know. So if you want to ask me about the mountains and the world and geology and all these things, it has to start with the consideration of who God is, the fear of the Lord. It's the beginning of wisdom. And we throw God out and then we come up with all these theories that don't make sense. No, he has to be first. In the beginning, God. He has to be the first thing that we think about when it comes to giving, how we love our mates, how we serve one another. What am I going to do next? I'm not going to get on TV and listen to Steve Harvey. Amen. I'm not going to get on the Wall Street Journal to figure out where all my money ought to go to. Maybe second. I could watch the stock market, but the first thing you do is ask God what he wants you to do. And there are some things that are eternal. That giving is principle. There's a tragic story in the Bible, I don't mean to scare you this morning, of a woman who lied about what she was given. It was her money. What are you lying for? And God wasn't even mad. It's your money, but why are you lying? He said to the Holy Spirit. A lot of times we think we're lying to God's men or God's woman. We're lying to God. You know? But just be honest, make some appropriations, and consider this, that a tenth is holy to the Lord. Yes. Holy. Sacred. Well, rationally it works out, don't it? If I gave a tenth of what I had, it ain't going to make or break me for the week, is it? But it's a solid acknowledgement that I trust God, that I believe in the principle, that I'm not sowing upset and mad, because God loves a cheerful giver, right? But this is what he says. I promise you, if you sow sparingly, you're going to reap. And we don't give just to get back, but I'm giving to get back. When it comes to God, oh, yeah, I fully expect him to keep his promise to me. 30, 60, and 100-fold, and some of us have not seen the manifestation of things. Oh, we got a little something. You got a little car. You got a little house. But God wants to widen your stakes and strengthen your cords and broaden your life, and even when it comes to investments, because you can't do it because you... Let me peel one off. I'll give you a one off the top. You know, God sees into our heart, and if he's given so much to us, and the great, great, great blessings are not monetary. Sometimes God will extend your life. He'll extend your health. He'll do things in your kid's life based on the fact that he knows you're not withholding nothing. Don't hold nothing back from God. The last thing I'm going to hold is some money. You can have the money. You know, some people have a natural gift to give. And the Bible lets us know that there actually is a gift to give. To actually give is a gift. And what the real gift is that they have the resources. So a lot of times you see people who give a lot, they have resources because God has given them the resources to give. But it doesn't matter if you're Donald Trump or if you're Johnny Lee. God has commanded to be a giver. In church, in your time, in your service to God, give him the first that you got. God does not, he's not a second place God. He doesn't do seconds. You could give it in second place, and he don't get no glory, one, because he don't need it. You see, women, you know what I'm talking about, because y'all get an attitude. You say, I don't need you. Do it. I don't need you. And God don't need us. I promise. But he wants us. But he wants us. But it has to be his way. He doesn't have to change his course. He doesn't have to change his law. He declared it. We receive it, and that settles it. That's what we say. But really, he declared it, and that settles it. It don't matter if I believe it or not. You know, so we want to be generous givers. Honey, if you want to come now, you can share some announcements. I don't know if she has it written, but I'm going to share this. Starting at the first of next month, we're going to start our services at 10 a.m. 10 a.m. We're going to try to get everyone out a little earlier so you can enjoy your day. Okay, 10 a.m. And then later, we might start even earlier than that. But right now, we're going to go back to the 10 o'clock start. The bishop went earlier when he was pastor. They started at 10. We're going to start at 10. So everybody now that comes at 11:30 can start coming at 10:30. They clapping. Ooh, Lord, have mercy. God is good, I'll tell you what. Oh, man. But we want to get everybody in here, get out, go home, enjoy your day. I really would like to start at 9, personally, and get out at 11, because wasn't it a great thing to enjoy your Sunday? Oh, absolutely. Yeah, and not to rush the service. Service is still going to be just as long, but I'm talking about you, because most of the Sabbath day is supposed to be about you enjoying your day and with God. And a lot of people just use it as a day to make double time, but that's not what Sunday is for. I'm going to teach a message soon called Holiday or Holy Day, and you've got to figure out which one it's supposed to be. Because Sunday used to look a lot different years ago. You know that? Yeah. Oh, man, there was a time when you couldn't go get drunk on a Sunday. There wasn't no liquor to buy. You had to buy it illegally. Sunday was a totally different day. But they've obliterated the external things, but it's still sacred. And when you go to the Old Testament to find out why God did that, he said, remember, I brought you out of Egypt. Yeah. That's why we come to church. I don't want to hear all the external stuff and the reasons and the excuses and all this crazy stuff. No, the reason why we have the Sabbath is grounded in redemption. That's why we come. And we got all these crazy religious folks that try to say, oh, well, I don't know if the Sabbath is on Saturday or Sunday. Well, come here and sit on Saturday then. since that's what you want to do, but honor God. Because he has parceled out a day in history for our rest, for consecration, for the word of God, for Christian meditation. Oh, it looks different than it used to. But our house wasn't no joke. We had some gospel music going on all Sunday, every day, really. My father was a pastor. But we knew how to honor that day. You know, we don't want to be, I guess, can you be over spiritual? Yeah, I think you can. God, you know, you can't walk around saying Tasha Cobb all day on your job, can you? And, you know, they want you to get busy, get to work, says Aretha. But at the same time, there's a day parceled out in time that God has set aside for our meditation and to honor God and make that day holy. If you are watching Ozarks all week, shut Ozarks off on Sunday. The pastor's instructing you now. Change things up a little bit. Each day is supposed to be different, but when you get older and you bring your kids to church, and they're at a college party, and they're drunk on hangover on a Sunday, they'll, in the back of their mind, the Bible says they'll never forget it. If you train up a child in the way they will go, it'll never depart from them. They'll know that every Sunday, they'll know where I'm supposed to be. Right. It's not a guarantee they'll be saved. It's a guarantee that it'll be stuck like the hound of heaven in their head. I know where I'm supposed to be, because we all go wrong, right? But that conviction will always stay. It's Sunday. This is where I'm supposed to be. I need to pray. This is my time to renew, to refuel, to get what God has, to get a fresh revelation from God. This is my time. And if you miss that day, the Bible says if the root is holy, then so are the branches. Your whole week is a mess because you messed the first day up. That's a fact. If you don't get it right first, then you wonder what's going wrong all week and all hell done broke loose, because God needs that first connection. He's always got to be the principal part. All right, I'm done. All right, sweetheart, come on.
And right before we give our offering, I just wanted to review just a few announcements for everyone. As the pastor already mentioned, at the first of the month, we will be changing our times of our service. And that also means our Wednesday evening Bible study will be moved from 7 p.m. to 6 p.m. Again, that's starting the first week of August. For those that are on the praise team, that means 9 a.m. every other Sunday. Also, we want you to remember, some of you signed up already to help with the parking lot ministry for the fair, but if you haven't, there is a sign up. You can see the pastor after church. We also want to invite all of you that want to attend. Pastor Lee and I will be graduating with our master's this Saturday. From Ball State University at Worthen Arena at 12 noon. No tickets are required, so anybody that wants to come, you're invited. And after that, about 4 p.m. at our house, we're going to have a little something, a little gathering, some cake and celebration. So feel free to come. We can give you the address, and we do have flyers afterwards if you're interested in coming. Okay. Any other announcements, Pastor Lee? All right. At this time, let us stand and... If you would start from the rear and just come around. Thank God for the gift and the giver. We thank God for all of you that gave. And so at this time, we're going to dismiss. If everyone would like to stand with us, give the Lord another hand praise for the word of God. This man. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my Redeemer. Shake someone's hand. Amen. Yeah.
Amen.